Senator Scharf received his degree from Harvard University, where his dissertation, working with Dr. Lawrence Colbert, analyzed the impact of democratic communities on inmate moral reasoning. He is the author of 8 published books, including Badge and the Bullet, Towards a Just Correctional System, and A Guide to JIS Performance Measures. He was invited to speak at the Nobel Prize event regarding technologies to support crime prevention, and has presented to events sponsored by Mr. Scott and the Crime Subcommittee on 4 different occasions. He is a professor of public health at the Louisiana State University School of Public Health and the Institute for Public Health and Justice in New Orleans. Did I pronounce that right?
Yeah, well, you can have some gumbo.
New Orleans. Okay. Shall I control your slides?
Yeah, that'd be great.
Oh, okay.
Hey, I'm so happy to be here. Quick thing about my crazy relationship with the Youth Promise Act. I met Bobby Vassar and Bobby Scott in 2006, and a few months later, my daughter Adria was having my first grandchild, Sahara, and I asked Bobby Vassar for a week off, and I went down to Richmond and watched Adria, my daughter's child Sahara, be born. And she's now in the 3rd grade. So we've been doing this a while. You know, this has been going on. We've tried so hard, and I know this year we're going to get it through. I also want to introduce my colleagues, Dr. Stephen Flippy, who's a co-author of the paper. We hope you grab a copy because we think it's pretty cool. And it outlines some of the discussion issues that we'll get to at the end. The last thing, I'd say one thing about New Orleans. We are living this problem. This is a real academic for us. I had a visitor come visiting from NPR a couple days ago, wanted to talk about Hurricane Katrina. And she was late. And our vice president of public affairs said, where is she? NPR is always on time. We had an AK-47 shootout on Canal Street, a block, 2 blocks away from the French Quarter. And 3 days before that, we had 2 kids exchange gunfire, 16-year-olds. And while I was up here, we had a 17-year-old killed and a 4-year-old wounded, a sibling wounded. So we are living the problems that Becky and Denny and Kristen are talking about. We really have. Okay, a few things. Let's start. Okay. One. What does the field think causes violence? And I took this from Levin, Trigonomics. We just did a broad overview. Why? What is it? And there are a number of factors that are associated with violence that come out of different literatures. This is really from the economics literature. The importance of a cohort, demography. Early school failure, school discipline practices. There are just a number of things that we know work. Now, over the last 20 years, and I think this is really the history of the Youth Promise Act, we've seen a decline in youth violence. And so why is that? Why are arrests for youth violence, or murder in this case, why have they declined? And arguments, hey, the police are getting better, criminal juvenile justice is getting better, society has changed, in some ways stabilized, we're more affluent. And while this has been going on, 2 things I want to observe in that first chart. One, we may have hit a stabilization point. Not the murder rates among young people are going to zoom to the sky instantaneously, but that there's no evidence that yet. But that we may reach a point where we need a major infusion of ideas and talent and energy to keep the rates being low. The second thing is, as the rates were going down, it's going down faster. And Bobby Vassar gets credit for this one. the budgets for juvenile justice have decreased approximately 94%. In the fiscal year 2000, it was approximately $1.1 billion between JBIG and other juvenile justice funding. This year, OJJDP, and I'll be visiting with them tomorrow, has $86 million in its budget. So the first question that I hope we discuss later is, have we invested sufficiently in programs, evidence-based programs, everything else, to keep these reductions in youth violence low? And that's a fundamental question from the field. The issue of, first issue, I think, is sort of, what are the mega problems that we face in this field? One thing in the map we put together really says there's a Pareto principle at work in the sense that very few cities have most of the youth violence. And these, as New Orleans, are high concentrated disadvantaged cities. They're high poverty cities. They're cities with significant narco economies. And years ago they did a Project Safe Neighborhood study. Their University of Michigan was doing the research, and they loved us in the University of New Orleans at that time, because we provided data on a great many murders. You know, youth murders are very rare for most communities, blessedly. But in the Detroits, and the Flints, and the New Orleans, and the Camdens, and the Comptons, it's a daily pattern of life. We have as many murders as we've had days in 2015. So the first thing I think we need to think about is sort of why, and discuss this, why this concentration of youth violence in certain places. Now, I'm my friend John W., Chief John Doe from Essex County, Newark, and we met working with the Newark Police Department. There are neighborhoods in Newark and New Orleans and Flint and Detroit, which have almost all of the murders. In New Orleans, there are areas, Lakeview area in New Orleans, they have no murders. None for a couple of years. We have, by the way, all African American communities in the river where they haven't had a murder in 5 years. So what is it about these high concentrations of youth violence that create these neighborhood level epidemics, and what do we do about it? That's something I think we've got to discuss later. Let me talk a little bit about some of the broader problems, and also New Orleans. There about 19% of the homicides, according to our studies, youth murders in the city. And our patterns of murders in New Orleans are, they're fascinating. One, summer disputes. There are other murders that are basically contract murders that the drug dealers will send young kids out, and they'll be working with the more organized drug groups in targeted assassinations. And this sounds horrible. I don't want to offend anybody or whatever. But there are these very complex, counterintuitive patterns that in these high murder cities. The other thing is we have a youth study center. And we talk about this and describe the statistics. Everybody in our youth study center is black, right? They had one or two kids over the last 3 years that were non-African American. And this question, which criminologists ponder, why the concentration of youth violence, especially youth gun violence, in that particular demographic. And the other thing is there are explanations. We incarcerate these kids at a much higher level. We also, the diversion opportunities for African American kids appear to be fewer, especially in New Orleans. the rate of school discipline and school expulsions and school suspensions is way higher. So we see these disproportionalities in every aspect of life in one of these high youth violence cities that contributes to the disproportionality in youth violence. And I think there are three, again, when we started the Youth Promise Act, and Bobby will remember this, in our first factual basis, we described programs that mostly were kind of low-level counseling, if you want to call it that, mentoring, structured interventions, but really not evidence-based. Educational programs, recreation programs, those kinds of things. 8 years later, I think the field, as Kristen and Denny articulated very well, have changed. And so if you were to get one of Youth Promise grants, what would you do now that you wouldn't have done in 2007? Because these things didn't really exist, or the research was in pockets and nobody knew about it. So what's new now? And the first thing is, and Stephen and I and several members of the panel were public health professors. And I think the integration of public health and youth violence is a mega trend. And does anybody recognize that object in the slide there? What is it?
It's a pump with the
Dr. Sayers pump in London in 1849. It was a cholera epidemic. And Dr. Snow did geomapping, really one of the first geomappings in public health, and found that the closer you lived to the London Street pump, the more likely you would die of cholera. And he had an intervention, and that intervention was to cut the handle off the pump. You know, and the analogy, and he must have had my murder class. Is sort of what's the analogy between Dr. Snow's pump and murder? Like, what's the alpha of the murder epidemic? And the and several people, you know, had great discussions prior to this event. We talked about social ecology, this idea of society as a biome, the idea of the interdependence of social phenomena, including youth violence. And what, this is so one thing. I think what we've done in juvenile justice and criminal justice is we've chased problems and we've chased kids. We never identified the problem. And we never thought about the social systems that lead, like that shocking picture you saw now that probably people have seen on the media, of two kids, three blocks from the French Quarter, Basin Street, shooting it out. You know, that kid shooting the other kid, 32 bullet casings found. That didn't happen because of a bad day or one particular event. There was a whole confluence of integrated forces that led to that event where the 17-year-old shot yesterday, killed yesterday. And for us to dig out of this hole, one of the things we need to do is to really think about what are the systems, right, that perpetuate youth violence, and the solutions, as with Dr. Snow's pump, what are the system interventions that can turn it around? Second thing, and this, I'm a fan of Denny's research, you know, she's the pro, is this whole, the whole contributions of neuroscience to an understanding of youth violence. And in the paper that Stephen and I wrote, I have what I call a life cycle view of trauma. And I think what people have done in this field as a reader in a part in some ways, is they look at DNA damage, maternal care, child abuse, school expulsion, going into a youth detention center, being shackled, being afraid that the drug lords are going to kill you, as discrete problems. What we argue in the paper, and I think there's some truth in it, and something I want to work with these great people who are really the pros in this, is how does this become a multiplier? How do all experiences pre-kindergarten you know, not being ready for kindergarten, when you have to make a choice about, you know, engagement with the drug dealers, or you see your friend shot, how does that exacerbate the trauma at different levels? And now I think we've looked at trauma, I can't wait to hear what Denny says because she's a pro, as a layer cake. Layer cakes are trauma, right? And I think we have to see it in a much more interactive way. The third megatrend that researchers such as all of us, is the work of SAMHSA, concentrated disadvantage. You know, what is it about North Newark? What is it about North Baton Rouge? What is it about parts of Chicago? The seventh district of New Orleans, East New Orleans. What is it about these neighborhoods? And Samson's idea, it came and went, it's coming back, is he has this notion of concentrated disadvantage. Childhood education is sparse or non-existent. Education is poor. You don't have a lot of jobs in the legit market. Kids, you know, the heroes are dope dealers. Kids come of age and they want to be part of the dope and gun culture. And the vector goes two ways, in my view. One, the environment, this concentrated advantage, shapes kids' lives. The second is, violent individuals can change the neighborhood. And I think what's the so what of that line of research is you've got to change communities as well as kids. The other thing I think when we started this, and you know, I was as much part of it as everybody else, we really thought of programs, and we thought about kid changing, you know, Tony Platt's child saving in a way. We never really thought deeply about the need to alter these highest risk communities. And this is very, I got a letter from great criminologist Hans Tock about the Stephen in my paper. And he said, if I'm a poor kid at risk, can I really wait for the neighborhood to change? And Hans is right, no. You know, you have to intervene with the kids as well as with the community. And how do you do that? What are the, I think there's some things I think that we need to think about in this field, you know, go a little further. One is the importance, not only of building on research, but the second thing is an objective assessment. That this is a very difficult political environment. So those of you who are researchers, I think to think of how do we all believe in prevention, and we all believe this works, how do we convince skeptics, of which there are many, that in fact this is a rational investment for society? So the importance of objectively assessing these efforts, developing outcome measures, developing activity measures, and also developing econometric measures to prove in fact that we save money. I think that we've been living in a certain way in this field on borrowed time, that we've ignored our critics and ignored our skeptics. And I think we need to prove that in fact these efforts at youth violence prevention in fact will produce result. A couple of just shocking numbers. If a young person is killed, the cost is about $1 million to $2 million to society. If they're critically injured, let's say through a spinal injury or a neural injury, it can be up to $6 million. In New Orleans, we could have 200 murders this year. And then, which translated into approximately 600 people, many of them young kids, being critically injured. We don't have enough money to pay on the back end for the consequences of youth violence. And we've got to be proactive on the front end, which is what this is all about. Again, the K again, these neighborhoods, this is very tricky stuff. The neighborhoods that have the highest rates of violence are the most alienated, the most disengaged, the most suspicious of outsiders, the most suspicious of people who want to do good. And how do you break down the barriers to enter these communities and introduce these great programs? Someone at lunch said the problem is not the quality of the programs, it's the ability to implement them. And I think a lot of us who work in these neighborhoods know how difficult this can be. And it's easy to work with middle-class kids, or sort of middle-class kids, they kind of like us and they want to go to college. They ask you, how do I get into Tulane or Harvard or LSU? The hardest ones are the snarly ones who don't want you in the neighborhood, think you're working for the police. And in this culture now, with all of the issues involving law enforcement, I think that alienation and disengagement has increased. Again, what's the so what? And I'm going to leave it here and I hope we get into the discussion. One, you're not going to turn this around. First of all, Obama's broke, our governor's broke, Mayor Lambie's broke. We can't go kid by kid. We can't go even program by program. We need a multidisciplinary social ecological public health approach. Most of the reason we're alive now has more to do with public health than medicine. It's clean water and toilets. It's much more efficient. The same thing is probably true here. The second so what, I think, is, and I'm really a fan of the people doing this great work with trauma. It's the aspirin cancer problem. And some of the treatments we feel comfortable with, first of all, they're old. Some work I do with Culver's and the moral recognition program, therapy, and aggression replacement therapy. I'm 70 years old. I wrote that in 1973. These programs have been sitting there forever. And that's where these new research approaches, I think, are of critical importance. Third thing, I think this issue of community changing, I don't know if we're real good at that. We're much more comfortable doing programs, going home, the idea of really engaging these communities and reducing the risks. The last thing is, and I said this before, but I think it's so important, unless we get a proffer that can be validated by skeptics, unless we show the efficiency, and that's where that performance measure document that Denny mentioned may be important. Why is there a rational cost benefit formula to justify youth violence prevention? Is it worth the investment? And as you know, there are people from different political points of view that will not, on the face of it, buy our claims unless we can prove it. So to go into this, and this bill will be successful, we will get it through. But to sustain it, we're going to have to prove that this is a rational business investment, and that the return on investment for the effort put in is reasonable and can be sustained. Thank you very much.